In Washington, it was Saturday evening, June 24th, 1950, 8:27 p.m.
Here's a hot one.
The news came over the teletype before anyone in official Washington knew of the attack.
Get me Lincoln White of the State Department.
Mr. White, the first governmental employee to hear the news in Washington, responded quickly. The lights in the State Department building burned late into the night. This was a time for immediate, decisive action. On the other side of the world, the attacking North Korean forces encountered only light opposition. The South Korean forces fled south in full retreat. For the people of the Young Republic, this was the beginning of one of the most tragic periods in Korean history. The South Korean forces had proved pitifully inadequate for the job of checking the invasion. But the communists' march across the South Korean countryside received a setback 3 days after the invasion with the arrival of U.S. Air Force planes. They went into action without delay, striking at military targets, with special attention to the enemy's lines of communication and supply. On July 1st, 6 days after the start of the aggression, American soldiers arrived in South Korea. The first contingent of U.S. troops was small in number and was committed as a holding force only. Fighting against odds as high as 20 to 1 against them, the GIs distinguished themselves in that most difficult military operation, the delaying action. But though the enemy was momentarily checked, from time to time in the deserted South Korean towns and villages, the communist offensive southward continued. By late August, the Red aggressors had seized most of South Korea, all except an area surrounding the port of Busan. With their backs to the sea, American and South Korean forces prepared to fight the crucial battle. It was a bruising fight for the battered U.S. forces. The American units took heavy losses. For most of the men, this had been their first taste of action. But by their courageous stand against overpowering odds, the Busan perimeter was held.
I'd like to introduce General John Michaelis, Commandant of Cadets, United States Military Academy at West Point. During those early weeks of war in Korea, the general was better known as Colonel Mike Michaelis, commander of the 27th Infantry Regiment, the famous Wolfhound Regiment. During those endless days and nights of continuous action, Colonel Michaelis' regiment was one of the few which kept the communists from overrunning all of Korea. General, I know it seems a long time back, even though it is only 2.5 years ago, but can you recall for us a little of the feeling of those first desperate weeks in Korea?
Well, then my impression, the major impression I have, of course, is the fortitude and the imagination and initiative of the American soldier in those early days. Days when very few were willing to fight overwhelming odds. It's of interest to me because it is the group of men without motivation, without indoctrination, who realized without being told that they were fighting something much greater and much larger than just the North Koreans. They were in fact fighting for their way of life. And as many soldiers have said to me, they would rather fight it in Korea than in their own backyards at Peoria, Illinois. The other impression, of course, I have is the tremendous amount of strain, tensity, confusion, fatigue that all the men had, and yet the remarkable sense of humor. I remember specifically during the bowling alley days at Taegu, when had the enemy cracked through our lines, it would have probably meant the end of the Busan perimeter. I received a note one night, or a message one night, from my 2nd Battalion commander, a Colonel Gordon Murch, who stated that in the message, 8 enemy tanks within our position, situation vague, we are holding, no sweat. It was that kind of a note that gave the men and the commander courage to carry on.
Tension during those early days was strong back here in the United States, too. I remember the setting was quite different. Nobody was killed, but I also remember there was something of a pitched battle going on out at the United Nations at Lake Success with Russia's Jacob Malik on the offensive.
The USSR delegation declares to the Security Council and to the public opinion of the world that the United States resolution is intended to extend the scale of the United States government's aggression against the Korean people.
U.S. Delegate Austin replied quickly.
The Soviet delegate referred several times to, quote, the aggression of which the United States is guilty against the Korean people, end quote. This statement has been repeated over and over through every Soviet-inspired channel on Earth. We've had it telegraphed to us by others. And we've heard it again today. It is a lie. It is a big lie.
On September 15th, 1950, the tide of battle turned by virtue of a daring amphibious attack at Incheon. With the Marines who made that assault was Time Life correspondent Frank Gibney, who was, by the way, the first American to be wounded in Korea directly after the North Koreans started the war. Frank, as I recall it, the chances were all against the success of the Incheon operation. Just how did that assault compare with, say, some of the World War II invasions in boldness and the general complexity of the operation?
Then it was one of the most complex operations I've ever seen, because the configuration of the tides and currents in Incheon made any kind of an invasion, even an ordinary landing by ships, very difficult. And in boldness, it was certainly a steal. But MacArthur got the idea, and this was one case where intuition carried it through.
And what was the general feeling among the troops of the chances for success?
The feeling was good, Van, because for the first time in those long months through Korea in the early days, we felt we were on a winning team. We saw all the might of the Navy out there, just the way it had been in the cruisers, destroyers, small rocket ships, and you had a feeling that you were part of a really great sustained effort, an effort that was coming all the way from home to win this thing.
Some of the Marines in the landing boats had been brought from duty in the Mediterranean. Others had been pulled out of the line in South Korea. A fair number of the Marines who went ashore that morning had fought their way across the Pacific in World War II. This was the same kind of warfare. The Marines were masters at flushing the surprised enemy troops out of their holes. The drive toward Seoul gained momentum.
On September 24th, only 10 days after D-Day at Incheon, U.S. Marines and soldiers were fighting in Seoul. The fight for the South Korean capital was bloody, but relatively brief. For 5 days, the battle for Seoul raged on. The U.S. troops took their losses, but efficiently stamped out enemy resistance. 3 months after the communist invasion, Seoul was once again free. Thousands returned to the homes they had abandoned before the communist thrust overwhelmed the Korean Republic's capital. Other thousands upon thousands had stayed on during the communist occupation. During the summer of 1950, many thousands of South Koreans were killed by their countrymen from the north. Whatever the future held for Korea, it could hardly prove more tragic than the early years of the infant republic's existence. In many lands, freedom had been achieved by bloodshed. But nowhere was newly won freedom put to a stronger test than in the Republic of Korea. By October 15th, United Nations troops had swept across the 38th parallel and seized a considerable area in North Korea. 2,500 miles east, Wake Island was the scene of a most important engagement that mid-October morning. President Harry Truman had flown 7,000 miles to talk with his top general in the Far East, a man he had never before met. They conferred for 1 hour in complete privacy, and then held a more general discussion in one of Wake Island's few buildings. This conference included the president's top military advisors, Joint Chiefs Chairman Bradley and Army Secretary Pace. Though only the two men knew what had been said at the secret meeting, they claimed to be in complete agreement. During that autumn of 1950, two forces of U.S. troops raced toward the northern boundary of Korea. On the left flank, the U.S. 8th Army, and on the right flank, the U.S. 10th Corps. But there was no communication between them. Major General Edward Ammon, commander of the 10th Corps, reported directly to General MacArthur in Tokyo, as did Lieutenant General Walton Walker, commander of the 8th Army.